Oh, good morning, everyone. It's a bit warm. I've just had to take my jacket off. A few more things about the service, just a reminder. The carol service is on YouTube tonight from 6 o'clock. The Christingle service is online at 3 p.m. on Christmas Eve. Christingle's packs are available from Jonathan still, I think. He did say deadline today, so I assume that's no one safe. Marion's nodding. A reminder of the Christmas services, the midnight service is not at midnight, 11:15 p.m. here. It's a joint service with St Bridget's, but it's here. Christmas morning, 9 o'clock at St Bridget's, 10 o'clock at St Mary's, Fast Family Communion here. Next Sunday, which is after Christmas, 10 a.m. at St Bridget's, no service here. Bookings for all these services have already been taken up, as far as I know. Fourth Sunday in Advent, service of morning prayer. Reminder that please stay seated for the hymns. We can't sing. Not allowed to sing. I wonder when we're going to be able to sing again. Ask Boris. You'd like to stand, please. The light and peace of Jesus Christ be with you. The glory of the Lord has risen upon us. Loving God, we've come to worship you. We're now going to light our fourth Advent candle. Di's going to come up and light it for us. Today we think about Mary, who bore Jesus in her womb, sacrificing her future for his. In this season of Advent, we're here to watch and wait and pray for the coming of the light into the world. We long for the day when things of darkness, selfishness and greed, suffering and impressions shall be no more. So let us light the fourth candle. We light this candle for all God's bearers, saying yes to God's challenge, accepting the pain and joy of an unknown future. Please sit for our first hymn, The Angel Gabriel from Heaven Came. Okay, confusion reigns here. The angel Gabriel from heaven came, his wings as drifted snow, his eyes aflame. All hail, said he, thou lowly maiden Mary, most highly favoured lady, Gloria. For known a blessed mother thou shalt be, all generations, Lord, and honour thee. Thy son shall be Emmanuel, by seers foretold. Most highly favoured Lady Gloria. Then gentle Mary meekly bowed her head. To me be as it pleaseth God, she said. My soul shall laud and magnify his holy name. Most highly favoured Lady Gloria. Of her Emmanuel the Christ was born. In Bethlehem, all on a Christmas morn, and Christian folks throughout the world will ever say, most highly favoured Lady Gloria. It's our time of repentance. The gospel calls us to turn away from sin and to be faithful to Christ. As we offer ourselves to him in repentance and faith, we renew our confidence and trust in his mercy. So in a moment of quiet, let us bring to mind the things that we have done wrong or left undone that we wish to bring to God. Just bring them to mind for a moment. Pray together. Merciful God, you made us in your image with a mind to know you, a heart to love you, and a will to serve you. But our knowledge is imperfect, our love inconstant, our obedience incomplete. Day by day we fail to grow into your likeness. Yet you are slow to be angry with your children. Forgive us for all that we have done to upset or anger you. Amen. So we receive God's forgiveness. Hear the word of grace in Jesus Christ. The love of God for us never fails. Nothing can separate us from that love. Rise up. We know we are forgiven and live in freedom and faith. Amen. Jenny will now give our reading from Luke.
The reading is from Luke chapter 1. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth with a message for a girl betrothed to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The girl's name was Mary. The angel went in and said to her, "Greetings, most favoured one. The Lord is with you." But she was deeply troubled by what he said and wondered what this greeting might mean. Then the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for God has been gracious to you. You shall conceive and bear a son, and you shall give him the name Jesus. He will be great. He will bear the title Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor David, and he will be king over Israel forever. His reign shall never end." "How can this be?" said Mary. "I'm still a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. And for that reason, the holy child to be born will be called Son of God. Moreover, your kinswoman Elizabeth has herself conceived a son in her old age, and she, who is reputed barren, is now in her sixth month, for God's promise can never fail. Here am I, said Mary. I am the Lord's servant. As you have spoken, so be it. Then the angel left her. This is the word of the Lord.
A colleague of mine from my district nursing days had many funny little sayings, some of them really very odd. But one of her favourites, and actually it's still quite a popular one, was this: you can't walk in another person's shoes. We may be able to empathise, but we can't actually know what it feels like. We may have had a similar experience, but we are all unique. We each feel and think differently. So that makes this situation, the visitation of the angel to Mary and the news imparted, in many ways impossible for us to fully understand what her feelings were or Joseph's. The account of that visitation of the angel to Mary and her acceptance of the situation is wrapped up very neatly in a few verses. Luke doesn't really go in for dramas or soul searching. So we can be forgiven for thinking that Mary accepted the situation with little problem. But did she? Did she really understand what the angel was saying? Or in that moment, was she so overcome with the enormity of it all that she simply agreed? Surely, Mary must have been scared at the thought of having a child. For in her own words, she tells us she had not had a sexual relationship with Joseph or with anyone. But would her parents believe her? And more importantly, would Joseph believe her? She must have been fully aware that if he decided she had been unfaithful, the penalty for her adultery, for that is how it would have been viewed, would at the very least have entailed him divorcing her. Divorce being the only nice way out of a betrothment. And she would have been left to scratch out an existence, most likely ostracized by both family and friends. And who would believe a young girl still claiming to be a virgin yet pregnant? And not only that, but claiming that she had been chosen by God to be the mother of his son. She must have struggled with this. She was very young. In one of the films of the Nativity, I think it was by Tony Jordan and a good few years ago, but it portrays Mary and Joseph as both being in anguish, really struggling to come to terms with the news. And to me, I think that is much more realistic and helpful for us. And yet, even at that early stage of the angel's visit, even though Mary must have known that life would never be easy or the same again, she not only accepts, she makes the journey to Elizabeth. And when Elizabeth tells her she also is to have a child, Mary bursts into a song of praise. My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Saviour. Perhaps that was the point where she really began to understand. Now, Jan is going to read to us a meditation from Nick Fawcett called Was It All a Dream? So we're just going to get ready.
Was it all a dream? Figment of my imagination? It feels like it now, I have to say. But at the time, it was all too real. Wonderful, exhilarating. Yet at the same time, terrifying. Blessed are you, Mary, for you have found favour with God. My heart leapt when I heard that. Me, Mary, singled out for special blessing, chosen by God himself. But then the angel spoke again. You will conceive and bear a son and call him Jesus. Well, that took some getting used to, believe me, the last thing I was expecting. And yet, strangely, I didn't put up much resistance. Just the one token query, how can this be? And then meek, docile submission. I marvel now, looking back, yet at the time it seemed perfectly natural, as though no other response would do. Why? Well, to be honest, I suppose I never really believed it anyway. I wondered, of course I did, and half accepted. Yet if you'd pressed me hard enough, there was always a little doubt at the back of my mind. The questions I couldn't dismiss. Had I misread the signs, imagined the whole thing? Or simply been listening to too many old wives' tales? But that wasn't the whole reason, for to tell the truth, despite everything, I wanted to believe it more than you'll ever know. Wouldn't you have, with a promise like I was given? He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom, there will be no end. Need I say more? If a child was unexpected, that was mind-boggling. A ruler over Israel? God's promised deliverer? Born of my womb, flesh of my flesh? It was too much. Beyond anything I could bring myself to imagine, and yet too wonderful to dismiss altogether. Was it all a dream? Well, you might still think so, but I don't, not anymore. For as I speak these words, I'm sitting in a stable, looking down into a manger, and there, gazing up at me, is my little boy Jesus. It happened, you see, exactly as I was promised, just as the angel said it would. And if God was right in that, then why not the rest too? How can I not believe?
When God chose Mary and Joseph, he chose people who would not only hear his requests, but two people who would obey, who would stand together and face the future through difficult times as well as joyous times. They may not have been wealthy in terms of finance, but what they had was a firm belief and love for God and for each other, and the knowledge that God loved them. God's ways are not our ways, and sometimes he makes demands or suggestions that seem impossible. So when he calls us to something new, we often just don't feel confident enough, perhaps, to step out and to try it. Most of us at some time or another will have had ideas that seemingly pop into our thoughts from nowhere. I don't know whether you've all received those, I'm sure you have. And if you're like me, I often try to dismiss them, but sometimes they remain and begin to take shape. Although I still might be saying to myself, no, I can't possibly do that, too much work involved, where would I begin? But things which seem impossible for us are not impossible for God. So it's important we all learn to consider and think, and most important of all, pray about seemingly impossible ideas, because they may well come from God. He may well be speaking to us, and we need to learn to listen and, like Mary, ponder and ultimately obey. And then we have to accept that if we take on a challenge, it might not be straightforward. We may well come upon difficulties we have to overcome. But with God, I'm positive we can see these things through one way or another to fruition. And if it doesn't work out, maybe we need to try again later. And God will tell us when the time is right. It's like a song that the children back in St. Giles, their drama group, used to sing way back in the 80s. And it was called In His Time. And one line went like this. And I'm not singing it. Although I was on the way down to church this morning. Lord, please show me every day as you're teaching me your way that you do just what you say in your time. Not in our time, but in his time. And that's often the lesson we have to learn. When we wait on God, he will lead us, support us, because he loves us. And that's why he sent his son, baby Jesus, to live among us on earth. So don't discard those pop-ins, you know, those pop into the brain. Think about them, pray about them. And if they are from God, he will let us know in his time, and help and sustain us as we carry out his work. Now we are going to sit and listen, I hope, to a song by Amy Grant called Breath of Heaven.
Mary might have been a bit uncertain what was going on, and I was a bit unsure as well, but I couldn't see the screen, so I'm not sure, but I expect they'll edit that bit out. And talking about being unsure, I was listening to the Sunday service this morning from St David's Cathedral in Wales. And the reading was a bit on further on from this. It was about the coming of the shepherds. And it just occurred to me, I don't know why, I've known that story for more years than I care to remember. But it suddenly occurred to me, the reason the shepherds went to see Mary and Joseph was to reassure her. I never thought, everyone else must know this, but it just occurred to me, they came to reassure her that God was with her and it was right. Okay, would you like to stand, please, for affirmation of faith? And stand together to declare our faith in the God who loves us. We believe in God the Father, from whom every family heaven and earth is named, God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. So please sit or kneel if you're comfortable for our prayers, which will be led by Ruth.
Father God, thank you for the ability to gather and worship you as we wait to celebrate your coming as a baby at Christmas. Thank you for Mary's courage in saying yes to you, despite the enormous risks and consequences for her. Father, give us courage to say yes too. We pray for your church. In this strange year, when our usual celebrations are so curtailed, let your church be a source of light and hope, a reminder of your love, a means of drawing people to your grace. Here in Berrow and Breen, we thank you for Jonathan and Marion and Joe and our team of readers. Give energy and strength to those leading in all of our churches. As our Christmas services take place over the next few days, may a joy which has at times felt distant be experienced in a real and revealing way. Father, we pray for the world in all its chaos. We pray for those involved in the last days of the Brexit negotiations and all involved in the outworking of their outcome. Give wisdom and generosity in those places. And as COVID-19 infection rates increase again, both here in the UK and elsewhere, and the rules about mixing at Christmas are tightened, help us to remember to behave with consideration and with compassion for others. We pray particularly for those who will be alone or vulnerable at Christmas. Help us to be outward looking, to see the need around us and offer love and support to others. Father, we have all been facing tough times this year, and we pray for those who are suffering in body, mind, or spirit, for the bereaved, the sick, and the struggling. And we take a moment now to bring quietly before God those who we know who are suffering at this time. Father, comfort them. Reveal your love to them. And as we begin to look towards a new beginning in 2021, fill each of us with the hope of your resurrection. I want to read a prayer from Jim Cotter, written for Advent. Loving God, calling your friends in new and unexpected ways, choosing Mary from the powerless and unnoticed in the world, yet greatly loved and cherished in your sight, that she should be the mother of our Saviour. So fill us with your grace, that we too may accept the promptings of your Spirit and welcome your angel with glad and open arms, ready to be pierced with pain and filled with joy, rejoicing in the cost of your salvation. In and through the same Jesus, our Messiah. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. We're going to close our prayers with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Our second hymn is that lovely Advent hymn, O Come, Emmanuel. And strangely enough, I heard it sung this morning at their service of St. David's Cathedral. But now we're just going to say it. O come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel, that mourns in lonely exile here, until the Son of God appear. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel, I'll come to thee, O Israel. O come, thou dayspring, come and cheer our spirits by thine advent here. Disperse the gloomy clouds of night, and death's dark shadows put to flight. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel, shall come to you, O Israel. O come, thou key of David, come, and open wide our heavenly home. Make safe the way that leads on high, and close the path to mystery. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to you, O Israel. O come, thou Lord of might, who to thy tribes on Sinai's height in ancient times did give the law, in cloud and majesty and awe. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to you, O Israel.
So we come to our blessing. Take that off. May the Father, who loved the Eternal Son from before the foundation of the world, shed that love upon us, his children. Amen. May Christ, who by his incarnation gathered into one things earthly and heavenly, fill you with joy and peace. Amen. May the Holy Spirit, by whose overshadowing Mary became the God-bearer, give you grace to carry the good news of Christ. Amen. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you, remain with you, those you love and those you pray for, this day and always. Amen. We go into the world to walk in God's light, to rejoice in God's love, and to reflect God's glory. Amen.